Hi everyone, and welcome to the show. This is a car that you don't get out of, you take it off. It's amazing. When you're driving, you're that far off the ground. It is amazing. And also, can you imagine getting out of the Morris Minor into a 430? Worlds collide. I'm Jeremy Cordeaux. This is the Court of Public Opinion. Welcome to the show. It's great to be with you here in the Court of Public Opinion. And it just seems like yesterday that I agreed with Channel 44 to do 16 weeks of the program. And this is the 16th episode of the show. Can't believe time goes as quickly as that. Around the city, the state, the country and the World Wide Web, the show like no other, from the garage like no other. David Pisoni will join us in a little while. I want to talk to him at the state level about education. And we'll talk about brands as well. Brands are a fascinating and very important subject because they kind of dominate our lives. It's good to understand a bit about that. We'll have our jury and, of course, a lot of things that you've sent to us during the week through our email, which I'll tell you about a little bit later on. This government is fascinating. You remember last week, I said that I couldn't understand Julia Gillard going off 5 months out from an election with the polls in terrible states. I mean, this Nielsen poll this week was, what was it, 29%? You know, that's hardly a mandate. But anyway, she went off with the highest powered delegation this country has ever sent to China. Now, as I mentioned last week, I couldn't understand quite what the Chinese would make of that. What decisions could she possibly make, knowing that it's a bit of a lame duck government from a lame duck prime minister? Well, now she's embarked on this education thing. Well, she doesn't actually call it education. It's another thing that amazes me. You'd imagine that a prime minister would have so many people around her, advisors, dozens of them, who would tell her there is no J in education. It's a D, not a J. They might have advised her on hyperbole. They might have told her that the opposition leader wasn't Mr. Rabbit. Go figure. But anyway, obviously there's nobody there who has the courage to stand up to the Prime Minister and say, listen, don't talk about that. But she's picked a fight. You remember when she picked a fight with the newspaper editors over the freedom of speech subject? We dealt with that a couple of weeks ago. They lost that fight, and understandably and quite deservedly, they lost that fight. And now the government picks a fight with the educators. And not just the educators, but David Gonski, the man who was commissioned to come up with this, I don't know whether Gonski is a noun, an adjective, or a verb. And as Simon Crean pointed out most eloquently, nobody understands what Gonski's about. They just want to implement Gonski. Well, David Gonski has now come out very vocally against the whole reform that the Prime Minister has shot out into the Court of Public Opinion. We'll see what you think about that and a lot of other stuff later on in the program. Stay with us. The program that shoots the breeze, never the messenger. Hope you'll enjoy it all the way through. If you're having a birthday or a wedding anniversary, I hope it's a nice day. It's an auspicious day for this country, one way or another. The year was 1770. This was the day Captain James Cook first sighted Australia. At the time, he thought Australia wasn't the so-called great southern land that he was seeking, turned out to be, but this was the day. This was the very day. And just in honour of my first guest, who has a business or a background in small business, 1955, and this was the day that changed, you could say, the eating habits of the world. The first McDonald's hamburger shop in the world opened at 400 Lee Street, Des Moines Plains, Illinois. Closed the 2nd of the 3rd, 1984, but opened this day in 1955. Veteran of the Korean War, Fred Turner, went on to become the chairman of McDonald's board. The shop took $366.12 on the first day. Hamburgers sold for 15 cents and chips for 10 cents. That sort of changed the world. David Pisoni, who is the member for Unley and he's also the shadow minister for education, is with us. Now, your background wasn't in fish and chips or hamburgers, but it was small business, wasn't it?
It was small business, starting from a very modest start, I suppose, Jeremy. It was I did an apprenticeship at a very old Adelaide firm that you would be aware of, Norman Turner and Nottage.
Oh, yes.
One of the fortunate things about doing an apprenticeship in a small business, I suppose, by someone that didn't really come from a business background. My father was at GMH, which has been very topical.
Yes.
GMH for 38 years, working in the tool room, working in small business. I got an insight as to how it worked. I also learnt that many of the customers of that small business were themselves business people, many of them tradesmen, that had started very modestly and ended up building very significant businesses. And so by the time I'd finished my apprenticeship at the age of 21, I thought I'm going to give it a go and see if I could start my own business. Well, 22 years later, the business evolved from a small backyard operation to one that had a shop on Unley Road,
yeah,
factory at St Mary's, another shop in Sydney. As a matter of fact, if I condense those 22 years, Jeremy, my first retail sale was a pine bookcase, and one of my last significant sales was the fit out of the Lowy Institute in Blyth Street in Sydney. So it gives you some idea as to how the company grew over that period.
New chapter in your life, being a politician, vastly different from small business, but may I say, small business needs somebody in politics who understands the engine room of this economy, which is small business.
I think that's right. And we're seeing that with Stephen Marshall. I mean, Stephen Marshall's small business background has been very prominent in how he's been delivering his message since that short time he's been the leader. I think it's about 9 or 10 weeks. And we are now talking about business, and we're talking about growing the economy, taking the handbrake off of business that we've seen placed by this government on business over the last 10 years. And we know that if we can encourage small businesses to grow, they'll get bigger, they'll employ more people.
Yes, yes.
And so it's a key factor of the South Australian economy in particular.
Yeah, well, my theory is that the trade union movement, represented by the other side of politics, should be in lockstep with you, because if government can help create jobs, and all you can do really is to create the environment where jobs can be created, the members of trade unions obviously will benefit from that as well. We're all on the same side, for God's sake.
We are on the same side, but the argument seems to be how to get there, Jeremy, doesn't it? We all want full employment, we want a strong economy, but the politics is how do you get there? And education is the same thing, I think.
Yeah, well, let's get on to that, because it really does seem that the Gillard government, having picked a fight with the media a couple of weeks back, is now picking a fight with education, schools, but most importantly, the universities. Now, what's the spin that you put on this business of taking the money out of universities while still growing the money that you're putting into universities? It sounds awfully like a three thimbles and a pea trick to me.
Well, I won't be putting any spin on it, Jeremy. I'll be telling it how I see it.
Yeah.
I mean, we've got a situation now where the Gonski review has been in the hands of the government since the end of 2011. We have the Australian Education Union has been running a Gonski campaign through that period of time. Remember, that was a recommendation of $6.5 billion in extra spending,
yes,
per annum in the with the recommendations. But the union saw that as an excuse to say that we want more teachers and we want more numeracy and literacy specialists. Well, there's 41 recommendations in the report, and none of those refer specifically to more teachers or more numeracy and literacy specialists in schools. I mean, everybody has their own version of what Gonski means. But I think what the Prime Minister has announced this week has been very unfair for South Australia. And I think there are two things that have been exposed this week. And one is that Julia Gillard is using the Gonski recommendations, or her version of the Gonski recommendations, just as the AEU used Gonski for their agenda, she's using Gonski for her agenda, and that is to get re-elected. We're seeing states like New South Wales, which have 48 seats in a 150-seat federal parliament, so it's a big chunk of the seats in the parliament. Many of those are marginal Labor-held seats, and we know that Julie Gillard is in office in a minority government situation, and so she can't afford to lose seats. She actually has to win seats.
But she doesn't have a mandate to do anything. She only has to look at the last Nielsen poll and all of the others to know that she is not going to win the next election, short of a miracle. So how can she go out and make these wide-ranging decisions when she doesn't have the mandate to do it?
And that's the problem with the Gillard government, is that all the decisions that they've been making, the announcements that they have been making, are all towards them getting a better result on the 14th of September this year, which is the date of the election, not for the benefit of Australians, not for a longer term vision, but to get over the 14th of September this year. I think even in the Australian today, there was a member of the Labor Party who was a student union representative in Victoria who was flabbergasted with the decision that the Prime Minister made to remove funding from further education. She said it's not the Labor Party that she knew. And I think that's the problem with the Labor Party at the moment. Nobody knows what they stand for, but we know what they want to achieve, and that is to hold on to power. And they're using any excuse. The attack on the media, they got that wrong.
Yeah.
Now the attack on the state premiers over school funding.
As and the South attack on the vice-chancellors and the chancellors of all of the universities, including David Gonski.
Well, of course, the problem with that, Jeremy, too, is that South Australia will lose per capita the same amount of funding that New South Wales will lose through the education, through the further education system, our universities, but we're only receiving $2,400 per student here in South Australia under the Gonski reforms into schools. New South Wales will be receiving $4,500 per student.
So it's pork barrelling. It has a lot to do with re-electing the government, not a lot to do with better educated kids.
It's a bad deal for South Australia. And Jay Weatherill can't get off the hook here because the excuse that the federal government has given for South Australia not needing as much money as New South Wales is that we spend more money as a state on education. Jay Weatherill must then explain to the people of South Australia, if that's the case, why is it that 5 years ago we were amongst the top tier states under NAPLAN results. Every year since then, our results have deteriorated. In 2011, we went backwards in 14 out of 20 categories.
Yeah.
Last year, backwards in a further seven categories. In all 20 categories of in NAPLAN, Jeremy, we haven't met the national average.
Well, at first glance, it looked to me like we were doing a better job of education for our kids, and we were going to get penalised under this new system because we had done a better job.
We're actually spending more, but we're getting worse results. Every other state has brought in reforms to their education system. Liberal governments have come in and they've introduced local school management.
Yeah, make schools autonomous.
Give the principals the decision,
yep,
and the ability to make those decisions. Hold them accountable, yep, too, of course, but make those decisions that best suit their students.
David, just quickly. Now, all of this, PM picks a fight with the states, second class for South Australia, all the headlines that she's going to have piled upon her. How much of all this stuff has got to go to a vote in the federal parliament? Do you know?
Well, there'll be the Gonski reforms, I imagine, will the funding for that will, if they do manage to seal an agreement on Friday, remember it'll be the COAG meeting on...
push this through.
They can push this through. They've got the support of the independents to push this through. There will be substantial problems for South Australia because we're only getting half the funding of states like New South Wales. And the ironic thing about this is that New South Wales have the highest academic outcomes, and yet they're getting more money than what we're receiving here in South Australia.
Obviously more to come.
More to
David,
come.
David, thank you.
Pleasure indeed.
Thank David Pisoni, who is the Shadow Minister for Education, here in the Court of Public Opinion. Summer days and summer breezes. Now, I would love to read you everything that Barbara has sent me, but it's not going to fit. We need an hour and a half program instead of an hour program. That's probably what we need. Don't tell Amber I said that. But when I was talking about Lincoln, the movie, not the car, Lincoln, the movie, Barbara went to see it. And the reason I bring this up is not only the stuff that Barbara sent me, but it is, in fact, this week that we remember in 1865 that Abraham Lincoln was shot dead. Well, he wasn't shot dead. He died 2 days later. John Wilkes Booth at Ford's Theatre, Washington. The play was Our American Cousin, an English comedy by Tom Taylor. As I say, he died 2 days later. But Barbara sent me this, which is this, and I can't read it all, but it's about failure. You know, would you ever associate Lincoln with failure? I wouldn't, but listen to this just quickly. When failure continually knocks at your door, welcome it in. Once experienced and learned from, failure becomes a stepping stone to success. Lincoln, who had one formal year, in fact, less than one formal year of schooling, his whole life is littered here with failure. He was defeated in 1832 for the legislature. He had a business failure within 1 year. He was defeated for speaker in 1838, defeated as an elector in 1840. He married into a burdensome life and an unhappy relationship, defeated for Congress in 1843. And so it goes on. He couldn't get a job. He couldn't get the woman he loved. At 45, he ran and was badly defeated in the US Senate 2 years later. In 56, he became a candidate for vice president and again was defeated. Failure stood at his door in 1858 when he was again badly defeated for the US Senate. And when he was assassinated, these years later, in fact, fairly soon after his death, Edwin M. Stanton, this is thanks to Barbara, I've got all this in front of me, spoke of this man, this failure, Abraham Lincoln, and said, "We will remember him. Here lies the most perfect ruler of men the world has ever seen, and now he belongs to the ages." Yet in his day, he was a failure, and everybody laughed at him. In fact, they even laughed at the Gettysburg Address, they tell me. Barbara, thank you for that. Sad time. Now, let me introduce you. I suppose if you could have a brand, an Abraham Lincoln brand, you'd be kind of cooking with gas, wouldn't you? Let me introduce you to a professor. Now, I don't know, I could say he's a professor of brands, but let me introduce you to Professor Byron Sharp, a man who has written the book on brands. They're fascinating because they do rule our lives.
They're a huge part of making our lives simple, actually.
Because I know what brand I like, or because I'm intimidated?
No, because I know what brand I like, or I know what brand I use. They really do make our lives so much easier.
How strong is the brand?
Well, brands are very strong, but not for the reason most marketers think of. Most marketers like to think of consumers falling in love with their brands, having a passionate, deep relationship. But reality is we have lives, and brands make it simple. You know, you can get into your supermarket that has 30, 40,000 items looking at you, and you can do your shopping in 15 minutes, which actually sounds impossible.
Right, so it makes choosing easier.
Indeed, it means we can do a lot of buying and not much thinking.
How do you put a price on brand? For example, Coca-Cola. What's Coca-Cola worth, just the brand?
Well, if we think of it, you know, what does Coca-Cola own? I mean, it has a very nice building in Atlanta and you know, a few computers and things like that. It really doesn't own any, I mean, it has, I think, a tiny factory that makes some syrup and things, but it really, you know, it hardly owns anything.
Is it the formula or the brand?
No, it's the brand. I mean, you know, if you were offered, which would you like, the formula or the brand, you'd take the brand.
Yeah.
The formula, it's a lovely story about the, you know, the locked safe or the secret formula, but I think any chemist could tell you they can make Coca-Cola in 10 minutes.
Mm. But it's hard to put a dollar value on something like that.
Well, we can put a dollar value on it. That's a lot of money.
You see, there are a lot of brand name cars around here. Most of them are old, as you can see, Professor. But the point is, I find it easier to fall in love with a 47 Jaguar than I would to fall in love with a 47 Acme or a 47 Bumper.
Right.
So the name means a lot.
Well, the this is a little different. This is collecting, whereas you know, for most of consumers, brands are, they're almost a necessary evil. It's like, you know, I want an ice cream. I have to buy into the product category. You know, I want that, and I have to choose a brand.
Yes.
So consumers are just amazingly loyal. They quickly decide that this brand is, this one's okay.
Yeah.
I know what it looks like, it works, and then they get on with their lives.
What do you think of the constant marketeers who are saying to proprietors, oh, you need a new logo.
Yeah, I know.
You need a new
logo.
You
need to modernize, refresh. Yeah. Well, that, you know, that's them trying to create their own brands and create their careers. But consumers don't ask for these things at all. We love, Coke is, in most countries, dominant. It's Pepsi. And if you look at Coke's logo, you know, 100 years ago, it's exactly the same.
Yeah.
Whereas Pepsi has tinkered and changed. It's always changing. And this has hurt the brand.
Yes. Speaking of brands, I think an iconic brand, particularly for South Australia, but all over Australia and other parts of the world as well, is R.M. Williams. And I see, to my surprise, and I would have thought it would have been a darn right front page story, that they have sold, not the whole thing, but the Australian iconic clothing boot maker R.M. Williams has fallen into foreign hands. Did you know that? Well, I remember when Ken Cowley, who was the former head of News Limited, bought it out of, I think it was bankruptcy. Anyway, he has now sold 55%, they say here, to the Louis Vuitton Moet.
LMBH.
Mm. Right. So they are obviously aware of one of our few iconic brands.
Yeah, I was thinking only the other day, we have very, very few luxury brands in Australia. You know, we have Penfolds, and I thought R.M. Williams, Juleek is also a potential.
Yes.
Very few.
Why is that? Why have we missed that boat?
Brand building does require, it requires expertise, it requires marketing expertise, it requires scale. Australia hasn't had that. We tend to...
A la Holden.
We tend to, you know, we lose a lot of our bright people to the big cities of the world.
What do you think is the most valuable brand in the world?
Most valuable brand in the world? The ones that come to are the brands like Apple, Google, Coca-Cola. These are brands that have managed to get into the heads of millions of people and teach them, you know, what it, basically, it's very simple things, yeah. Just teaching them what they do.
Now, these people didn't sort of start out to build a great brand. They obviously had a brand, and then they built a good product and a great product, and then the rest was history.
They built a great product and they did great marketing. I mean, it's not, you know, the world doesn't beat a path to your door if you just build a great product. They did the stories of, I mean, Apple got into great problems when it still had some very great products and some fantastic software, but they were marketing themselves into a smaller and smaller and smaller niche, and then they embraced mass marketing. They rolled out stores faster than anyone else in the world. They advertised when they launched the iPod every single quarter. They didn't launch with some advertising and then sit back. They rolled every quarter, they increased their advertising spend, and it started as a sort of a niche product that you can only plug into high-end computers, and they made more models, lowered the price, and moved it out into every single distribution channel they could.
The power of the brand. Now, you lecture to people at the university.
Mm.
What is the course? Is it marketing or branding, or what do you call it?
Well, we have a whole degree in marketing, so we have quite a few subjects, but I'm a research professor, so I don't do a lot of lectures. But we're sponsored by companies all around the world, including companies like Coca-Cola.
What are you working on at the moment?
At the moment, we're working on things like...
You can trust me. Tell me.
lots of things. And marketing is sort of virgin territory. Not very much is known about marketing. It's this lovely area all full of myths, and people have forgotten to actually go out and study consumers and see what people are doing.
And what's the book called?
How Brands Grow.
How Brands Grow.
And it's about studying consumers over the last sort of 50 years and seeing their repeated purchase and what makes the difference then between big brands and small brands. It turns out it's quite a simple thing. Big brands have a lot more customers. Those customers aren't necessarily much more loyal, they just have a lot more customers.
Hmm.
So they've been able to get into the heads and to be easy to buy for lots of consumers.
Critical mass. Professor, I could talk to you all day. I really could. Because there have been so many success stories and so many people who have stuffed it up. with brands and fail to understand how all of that works in the human mind.
Yes, it's a great story when British Airways took the Union Jack off the tailplane, and Richard Branson, who understands brands, went, "Great, I'll take that." And immediately started painting the planes, and that shocked British Airways so much they brought the Union Jack back.
Professor Byron Sharp, thank you.
Thank you.
I got to read that book, How Brands
Grow.
How Brands Grow. Professor Byron Sharp, in the Court of Public Opinion. Our 16th show, Who Said It Wouldn't Last? Now, actually, speaking of that, I'm assuming we have a show next week. Have we heard from the executive producer? We haven't. Well, I tell you what, in a wonderful moment of optimism, I have booked Frances Nelson QC, who has one of the most difficult jobs in the world. She is the chairman of the parole board. Can you imagine deciding who gets out and who stays in? And we've all argued the case about some fairly difficult decisions about letting some people out because they seem to go back in. Anyway, that's all next week. If we're here next week, if we get some late news from our executive producer, I shall pass it on. Meantime, our jury. Caroline Peacock.
Hello.
Are you well?
I'm very well.
Oh, good. Coralie Cheney.
Hi, Jeremy.
And Karen Stevens.
Hi, Jeremy.
Welcome to you all. We were talking about brands a little bit earlier. And while I've got it on the telephone, goes to show you there is always a market for a good brand. And when I was at Scammell's yesterday, having a look around, as I always do, I found, and Anna's got this from my telephone to put on the screen, a couple of the most unusual things I've ever seen at auction. Three or four packets of Amguri tea for auction, and a packet of Wheaties.
Good luck.
Separate lots. This wasn't a package deal. Separate lots. Could you imagine somebody going and buying at auction a box of Wheaties?
It'd be worth nothing when the commission comes out.
Or goes on.
Comes off.
Yeah. Well, I've got to go back next week and find out if they sold. I shall report, if we're here, I shall report back as to how much the Wheaties went for, because I'd love to know. Mm. Now, the things we've looked at this week, the education issue is certainly a very, very important one. If you read the newspapers, we're being gypped by the federal government. If you read the newspapers, it would seem that the chances of the state premiers signing up to the deal that Julia Gillard has put forward is very, very slim. $14 million chucking that at our children. Who's responsible for where that extra money goes? What does it go on? Caroline, what do you think about?
I think it's just something to take our mind off everything else that's happening. It sounds good that the children are getting more money invested in their schools, but then the universities are missing out. But it doesn't seem, if you actually look at it, real, because they didn't speak to the premiers ahead of the announcement. They didn't speak to the universities or the schools. So nobody has been made aware of any of these facts, and it's just pacing time to September.
But I don't get it. If you haven't got a mandate and you know you're going to lose the election, you can promise almost anything. She could have promised 30 million. Doesn't matter. It's only money. She'll never have to live up to it.
Yes, sorry. Well, you know, as John Howard said, there are core promises and non-core promises. And this is obviously a non-core promise.
Then there are things that you know and things that you don't know that you know that you don't know that you don't know that you know.
Exactly.
Okay, I'll think about that one. I think, I mean, yes, you're right.
Rumsfeld, 4 years ago. Go on.
It goes back to those whole election promises, and often you find pre-election all these lovely things come out to make people forget the promises that they haven't fulfilled or the lies they've made during their election term. And, you know, you get the stimulus package or whatever, and then all of a sudden people vote them back in again, and that's the plan, that they forget the promises that have been made or haven't been fulfilled or whatever. And then there's this last minute spur of pleasure, I suppose, in some form to make everyone think, oh, they're doing such a wonderful job.
Well,
on both counts.
Maybe we can morph this into election promises as well. I mean, there's the old joke about how can you tell if a politician is lying. His lips are moving. Or her lips are moving. I don't know. What do you think, Karen?
Well, if there's anything consistent about politicians, it's their inability to keep election policies or election promises. So you think about, well, obviously, the GST with Howard. You think about...
But he did go back to the people and say, you elect me, you got a GST.
He didn't
slip it through to the keeper.
No, that's right.
That's true. Well, Menzies with troops to Vietnam, that was misleading. And maybe we could have an independent watchdog that maybe has an honesty poll for politicians that the public can actually access, so we can have a look at their honesty rating.
No. Just a big scoreboard. Yeah. Like, you know, you have at the footy where they, you know, have promises and they tick the boxes or they get a big cross. And then at the end of the term, we can see whether they, you know, what they fulfilled.
But what about just the simple trade practices law that exists for every advertiser in the world? And after all, a political campaign is an advertising campaign. You have to keep your promise, because if you don't, you get fined or you go to jail or you're in some other way penalised.
Yeah, absolutely.
That would make sense. Here is what you think.
I'm a bit worried about what's going to happen to higher education. If I was a university student now, I'd be very worried about whether I could pay for my education.
Public versus private.
Yes.
I'm a public girl.
Yes.
I raised a public kid, and I feel the priorities are wrong.
Well, I think it's all smoke and mirrors, Jeremy. I really think it's robbing Peter to pay Paul, and it's the wrong way to go about it.
I think it's just a politics change at the moment, and the reallocation of money is just putting it from the right hand to the left hand, so I don't really think it's a benefit at the moment.
And another question in the Court of Public Opinion we're asking is, how do you keep politicians to their word? They go to an election, they promise this, this, this and this. How do we keep them to those promises?
It's very hard because it's human nature. I don't think you can. It's impossible. It's just human nature. They lie. And that's what it's all about.
And you accept that?
Well, I think you have to, because they're all the same. You go back in history, they're all the same. None of them ever keep to their promises.
That's a very good question. I don't think you can actually force anyone's hand in trying to keep their word. All you can do is just voice your opinion when it comes to re-elections to clearly show what they promised was not what they delivered.
Last week I was rabbiting on about this disability services pension, which I believe, well, number one, it's exploded. When I first started talking about this on radio, I think it was about 400,000 people were on it, and I found it hard to understand that there were 400,000 people who were disabled to the point where they couldn't get a job. That has now ballooned out to 825,000 people. My personal belief is that what the government is doing is just parking people in there while they try to find another benefit onto which they can go. But clearly we can't afford it. That's now for next year in the budget at current levels about $15 billion of the budget. Get your mind around that. Karen, what do you think about welfare? Do you think it's just too easy to get on welfare?
I don't know if the problem is easy to get on welfare. I think that it's more about once people are on welfare, where's the motivation to get off?
So, good psychologically,
most people, we want to contribute as a generalisation. Most people do want to contribute. Most people do want to be an important part of society and have their life to be meaningful and to have gainful employment and to contribute. It's an important psychological aspect and need. So really, it's about motivation to get people off. I think that there is a need for welfare. It's important that we do have that support network work for people in need, and it should be accessible for people. It shouldn't be impossible to get that support.
But it shouldn't be a safety net rather than a lifestyle?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And it should be like in America where you have a cut-off period.
Yeah.
After a period of time.
Because obviously there are people, families, who probably from no design or fault of their own, generation after generation after generation on welfare, And then how do you change that lifestyle?
Well, they did do that work for the doll, didn't they?
Well, it's, I think what they still that? Do that. Mm. And there's now
but
a lot
it's
of...
very limited. It's
and community work that, you know, if you are on some form of benefit, you do need to have some community work in order to keep receiving that benefit,
yeah.
Which is good. But, I mean, I was in China many years ago and everyone has a job. It doesn't matter if you're a 90-year-old little old lady, you've got to clean that little piece of pavement or you have to peel the beans for the family.
And this is socialism.
Or if you are with a disability, your job is to beg on the streets to bring in income for that family then to support, you know, to help support you. So everyone has a purpose, and I think as Karen said, you know, that's so important, and to feel reward of what you do. Now, when they're just continually receiving a benefit without that community service or some sort of work to try to find work, as involvement to try and find work, I think that's very detrimental to one's, you know, attitude and mental health.
Yeah, yeah. You've got to feel involved. You've got to feel part of the community. You've got to be...
Contribute,
be motivated, that'll go through to the children and their children and their children's children.
Right.
Here's most importantly what you think.
Today's society is very hard to live in, and yeah, it's very, we need to work, not just go on welfare, and yeah, we can't really survive without it.
I think it's a really difficult issue, and I think if you made it harder, a lot of people would miss out, and there's always going to be kind of people who get in through the sides, and there's a lot of grey areas, so I think it's okay. I don't think it should be made any harder, because I think then a lot of people would probably miss out.
Yeah, but this 825,000 people on the disability services pension, it seems like an awful lot of people who put their hand up and say they can't work. Maybe they're just being parked there by the government.
Possibly, but that means the system's not working. If it's easy enough to get onto it and do it, then I guess why wouldn't people try and take advantage of it? We've got to fix what's broken, fix the system first.
It does concern me somewhat when I see... really the young ones who find it very easy to live a lifestyle on the dole. And I don't think that's fair. When we talk about unemployment, we talk about these four, five, something or other visas that are supposed to be going. Why aren't our young youth working?
I don't really know, but I think anyone that is subject to a disability obviously suffers greatly, and if it's genuine, and so to say whether it's too easy or too hard is really a bit difficult until you nail down the detail.
Now here's one that I guess you could say it's out of left field or outside the square. I was thinking it's one of those very fundamental questions, but it is a question that a lot of people would dismiss as being rather frivolous. And it is simply, do you think there is a heaven? So if you think there's a heaven, you have to think there's a hell. But do you believe in that concept of, you know, gossamer wings and fire and brimstone, Caroline?
Well, it's a difficult one because you like to aspire to something in the future. Whether there's something there or not, I don't know. But it's also the way that we are raised as a society, that we aim to achieve and be rewarded. As we were talking, getting off welfare. I mean, you've got to try and improve yourself, improve your life. And even if you do it for no other reason than just to be a virtuous, well-meaning person. And it would be nice if there was a reward at the end. But if there's the opposite, if you're not a worthwhile or contributing person, is there a hell? I don't know.
But life ever after, or life in, I think Catholics say purgatory, which is sort of halfway between the two, and if you, of course, pay enough money
there
to the local church, you can
get out. There are different levels of hell, yes.
Hey, Julia, there's one you haven't thought of. That's a great one. You know, you go to hell, and if you... Anyway, never mind.
Which also raises the question, if you're really, really, really bad, are you in the highest level of hell, or is it worthwhile just being a little bit bad?
So if you're a shoplifter, will you be rubbing shoulders with Adolf Hitler? Mm-hmm. Is that the, Coralie?
Well, I mean, I believe in there is a spirit which is more than what our body is, and that goes on in after death. That, I mean, there's a lovely story about heaven and hell in the story of the soup. Have you ever heard that, Jeremy? So hell is a place where there's millions of people, and in the middle of it there's a big pot of hot soup, and everyone has incredibly long spoons.
Could be good.
But everyone is starving, and everybody is grumpy and angry because they can't actually feed themselves because the spoons are so long they can't get the soup to their mouths, right? Heaven, on the other hand, is a place where there are, you know, millions of people, and in the middle is a big pot of delicious hot soup. Again, they've got incredibly long-handled spoons. But in heaven, they've worked out that they can feed each other. And so everyone is content and happy and full and feeling cared for and loved.
That's a very slick answer.
To me, heaven is where God is. And if God is love,
yes,
then heaven is a place full of love and caring and peace, yes, and joy. Hell is a place where there is no God, if you might call it the devil or the lack of God, and therefore it's where there's a lot of anger and sadness and disappointment and jealousy and anxiety, etc. So we can have heaven on earth and we can have hell on earth too, depending on our state of mind.
Karen, what do you think?
Well, I've got two perspectives. I have a social psychological perspective, and I've also got a neurological perspective or explanation for the reasons why some people have had this experience of meeting God. So first of all, there was some Swedish researchers. Have you heard of this thing called the God helmet?
No.
God helmet, okay. These Swedish researchers were actually looking to help find a treatment for temporal seizures. So what they were doing is using different levels of magnetic stimulation throughout the brain in a bid to find a treatment. And what they found is that when they stimulated a particular section of the temporal parietal lobe, that people had these experiences that they'd met God. People actually were reportedly experiencing meeting another presence, meeting a bigger person or a bigger spirit than their own. So there's a bit of a neurological perspective on how is it that some people have had these experiences. Mm-hmm. And I actually also think that the concept of heaven and hell from a social point of view is actually, it's actually outdated, and I don't think that it's constructive to society. And in to support that statement, if you look at history, it's littered with incidences of jihads and crusades and all kinds of different things that people have fought and, yes, and done atrocious things, all in the name of achieving heaven, yeah, 9/11 being an example. Yeah,
yeah. But that's men misusing God. They're blaming God. Mm. I don't think you'd have a bar of what people do in his name. Here's what you think.
I neither believe nor disbelieve. No one's given me the evidence. I mean, they think they give me the evidence, but I haven't seen the evidence for myself. Therefore, I cannot believe.
Well, no, as I say, there's one God, and nobody has ever come back to tell us what's up there or what's down there.
I do believe in it because I'd like to think there's something after I die. That's why I believe in it.
Does it change your life? I mean, does it make you live a better life, thinking that if you live a better life, you'll go to heaven?
Yeah, of course. To a certain extent, but I don't believe there's a place up there and a place down there. I just believe that there's goodness and badness and in everybody and more than a natural place.
Is the concept of heaven and hell a good force on life, do you think?
I think for many people it gives them something to think about or something to, I don't know, to live their life by, so that they can measure what they're doing as in, I want to go there, or I want, you're going to end up down there.
I believe there is a heaven, yeah, definitely.
And who's in there?
I've got no idea. I'm going to wait and find out.
Will you be in there?
I'm sure I will be, most definitely.
To me, it's all in the mind. I mean, I'm a Christian. I don't go to church anymore. But, as I say...
Is there a devil?
Sometimes, yes.
Yeah, but as I said, you know, there's obviously money in religion because, you know, with the old selling indulgences, it was possible for you to pay enough money to buy God off. And I've always thought about that as being a bit like the carbon tax. You know, if you pay enough money to the church, you pay enough money to the government, your sins, your carbon sins or your moral soul sins will be forgiven. And they'll never know whether you've gone to heaven or none of it makes any difference, really, because we can't prove after the... Are you with me on this?
No one's come back with souvenirs, as far as I know.
Anyway, it is lovely to see you, and I'm sure that all of you with angels' wings and looks are going straight to heaven. Thank you. Caroline, Coralie and Karen.
Thank you, Jeremy.
The jury in the Court of Public Opinion. No time to talk about it now, but next week, if we are here next week, did you know that if you have a bank account that you haven't used for 3 years, the government can take whatever money you have in that account? Well, look at it. Speaking of looking at it, Betty Samis.
How are you, Jeremy?
You've been about and looking at just about everything.
I have been looking at everything. I was actually surfing the internet the other night.
Oh, yes.
And I could not believe I found this, and I want you to check it out. You'll find it quite interesting.
It's not about winning. It's about the pursuit of excellence.
Hey, let's go out and celebrate, man. We just won a World Cup match.
It's a losing mark.
Don't start winning again.
It's the World Cup. The most important thing in the world.
We're winners, Frank.
At what are we winners, Mark?
Saxon, you found him.
Found him on the internet. Look, I was quite surprised I found him on this site. I was expecting another site to find him on. But
yeah, I've seen him act. I think he's a good actor. But gee whiz, it's a terribly hard row to hoe.
Look, everything is a hard road. And look, this movie, Total Football, that he was in, was a hard road for the director as well. He raised $80,000 through local business. He put the movie on himself. He got no help from anybody. And it is a great movie about a soccer club. It's about players, it's about their dedication to the sport. And, you know, there are fanatics in Australia. Soccer is just not one of those games that is really embraced by the media. And, you know, people getting up at 4 a.m. in the morning to watch matches, and it's centred around the Socceroos match in 2006. So Saxon did such a great job in this. What a great actor. I mean, he was among all these other fantastic actors. Georgie Speakman, who you met.
Yes,
remember, we were out
indeed
at that function that night. Limo, Pete Michelle, who has done so much stuff with the State Theatre Company. Eleanor Carapetis, a NIDA graduate. Peter Evangelista and Joel Scalzi. So, you know, among so many other people who gave their time to shoot this movie. Love the storyline. I think it's great. I'm not a soccer fan. I don't really get into a lot of sport. But the storyline was great. The acting was superb. So
yes.
totalfootball.com.au. You can download the movie for about $4. And it's great. So,
okay. Now, you've been to the Tate. You've been to Turner from the Tate.
I did. What I did do is I stopped. It was a beautiful day and I stopped by the museum and bought myself a coffee. And then I went into the art gallery and saw these magnificent pieces. And I tell you what, it's only here till the end of May. You know, this is from Tate in London with over 100 works of art, and it's presenting the full range of his ambitions, critical triumphs and controversies. And at 13, he painted a detailed, precise view of Oxford. I mean, this guy is just such a legend,
and
you know?
It has a look, doesn't it? He's managed to create this kind of instantly recognisable style.
That's right. It's a bit like yourself, the recognisable style.
I don't know what a Turner is worth, but...
I know what a Cordeaux is worth. Anyway, let me just go on to the Northern Light Theatre Company. I love this theatre company. I've done a couple of shows with them. Community theatre gives you a sense of spirit, belonging. Little Shop of Horrors on at the Shedley Theatre, great for school holidays. The cast are magnificent. Rowan Watts, one of my favourite all-time singers in Adelaide who does musical theatre. You know, you can see now, I've just put some photos on the screen. It's colourful, it's joyous, it's music that you love, Yeah, it's stuff that you play through the show, and it opens up with three girls singing Little Sharp of Horrors. I wish I could get a copy of it. But great for the kids, and please support, you know, community theatre, because people put so much time.
Yes.
3 or 4 months of rehearsals. They don't get paid, and, you know, a bit like community television.
Support your local people, always.
And I'm quite surprised, because people stop me in the street and say, oh, love the Cordeaux show.
No, that's great. People like the local thing. I mean, look at the Spring Gully thing. If it had been the Acme Pickle Factory, there wouldn't have been this great reaction.
That's right.
People like the local product. We really, well, certainly in this program, are very grateful for the local support. But
that's right.
The local thing is very important
it
to keep going.
It is very important, and we should support it.
Yep. You're wonderful.
See you next week.
I will really look forward to that, Betty. You're fantastic. Now, our pet of the week, and thank you, Peter. Sheedy, S-H-E-E-D-Y. Sheedy. Hello, I'm Sheedy. I'm the Animal Welfare League pet of the week. Very handsome. It's a girl, so it's very pretty. I'm a quiet 14-year-old female domestic short-haired cat. Don't let my age fool you. I love being the centre of attention. Please come in and visit me. Once you spend some time with me, you will see that I am just looking for a loving family and I can spend my twilight years with you. Cats usually sleep around 16 hours a day, and that sounds good to me. Can you see me relaxing on your windowsill? Very good-looking cat. I'm de-sexed, microchipped, vaccinated, health checked, and only $60. Come see me at the Animal Welfare League, 1-19 Cormac Road at Wingfield. Peter Sellen is the guy who does a lot of good work out there. 834-81300. That is the show. Now, I want to thank all our sponsors. I want to thank our wonderful crew who come along here and volunteer and put this whole program together. All our guests, our regulars, but most importantly, I want to thank you in the Court of Public Opinion. Believe in yourself. I'm Jeremy Cordeaux. Bye for now.